Everyone, you braved the snow. Good job. The good news is it was not snowing when we unloaded the van at 7:30 this morning, so we got to escape it. I'm going to invite you to stand. We're going to worship together. Before we do that, I'd like to pray. Would you join me in praying? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we are all here today, that we got here safely. And Lord, we are looking forward to worshiping you this morning. So I pray that our worship, it pleases you, Lord, and that we can just express our joy in what you've done for us. God, I pray that our hearts are open to hearing your words during the message, and that we can just love being around your people this morning. And God, if we're here searching, like this is a new thing for us, Lord, I pray that this morning is one where we can just discover who you are a little bit more. We love you, Lord. We give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
with no point of reference. You spoke to the dark, fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of. Christ.
as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. And I don't know how many times in your life you have felt like a failure, like that one thing that you don't want to do, you keep on doing. Or the stuff you're supposed to do, you don't get done. But when our Savior forgives, He forgives all of that. 100 billion failures disappear. There is no record of them in God's mind when you ask for forgiveness from Him. And that's so encouraging to me. And He does that because we're His sons and daughters, you know, because He loves us so very much. There's nothing He wouldn't do for your kids. And God feels the same way. There's nothing He wouldn't do for you. When we're in relationship with Him, we have just to ask, and He reminds us that He loves us. He wants the very best for our lives. He wants us to be close to Him so we can be in that relationship. And there's a song we've done a couple times now, but we're going to do it because we need to be reminded who we are regularly, because that's what God says in His Word. Let's sing together.
I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love.
applaud for him. All right, before you have a seat, I want you to look around to the other children of God in the sanctuary. Tell them good morning and find out how their week's been. See if it was a good Valentine's Day or if they just forget Valentine's Day.
Didn't know how it sounded at first. Sorry. But it sounded, the audience just.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay.
I'm assuming he wants the armchair.
Yep, chair in front. All right, good morning again, guys. My name is Kim Hewitt, and I get the privilege of working with the worship teams here and doing all sorts of other stuff since I am married to the pastor. So, you know, we do stuff all the time. Just want to welcome you this morning. Specifically, if it's your first time here, I want to give you a big welcome and just say we're so glad that you are here. And hopefully everyone grabbed a communication card on the way in, although this week a lot of them are communication papers. That was me, printed out on the wrong paper. Mistakes happen all the time. So if it's your first time, we want you to fill that out and take it to the info table in the back on your way out. And we've got a special gift just to say thanks for coming and checking us out. And if it's not your first time, you still might want to fill out that communication card because there's all sorts of things you can put on it. You can put on prayer requests. You can have questions about ministries. So if you need to communicate with us, I mean, yeah, you can always email us or text us or something, but that's a good way if you're thinking of it now. You can just write it down, throw it in the offering plate on the way past. Teens, middle and high schoolers. I know some of you middle schoolers might be 12, but middle and high schoolers, you are having your first event after service today, 1 o'clock, over at the Rising Hope Community Center. The address is on here. It's just going to be a time where you get to, there's going to be food, there's going to be pizza. So you're going to have pizza, you're going to hang out, you're going to hear about kind of what youth group is going to be like this year and give your opinions on what you would like it to be like, because we want you guys to have a lot of input into what youth group looks like. So you're going to come over at 1 o'clock. You're also going to get all the details about the all-nighter. And that is coming up this Friday. So as your sheet says, you have to register for that online. There is a Rising Hope group you can register with. If you didn't register with a group and you're already registered, just let me know because we need to make sure we have enough spaces in vans for everybody. So if you're registered, you need to let me know. You need to let Derek know. Derek, you want to like hang out at the back or something after? Or let's see, youth coaches, could you do this for me? If you've come to the youth coach meetings, could you just stand up so people can look at you and be like, oh yeah, they're working with the teens. They're those crazy people. Yeah, see, look, there's crazy people. Woo! So you can find one of them and ask questions about stuff, and hopefully we'll know the answers to those things. We're just getting started, so grant grace. So teens, lots of stuff for you. And you also need, if you're not coming this afternoon, you need to somehow get a hold of the medical release form from church because we need your info. So if anything, you know, God forbid would happen to you, we know how to get a hold of parents and stuff like that. So you need to fill out one of those. So you need to get that today. Okay, stay tuned. This isn't on the screen, but stay tuned for church work nights. We did a couple really cool work nights last week. We got a bunch of stuff painted and trim painted and some outlets put where they're supposed to be and all sorts of fun stuff. So go ahead and stay tuned to Facebook and Instagram and the webpage, and we'll let you know when we're going to be over there again. It's looking good. 21 days of prayer. Raise your hand if you have jumped in on a 21 days of prayer, 9 o'clock Facebook thing this week. If you've been on at all. Cool. All right. So if you haven't and you're like, what are they talking about? At 9 o'clock every night for 3 weeks, and we started last Sunday, so we're just starting our second week this week, we're ending our day with prayer. And if you've got a request, and we need you guys to help out with this to make this really cool. If you've got a request, put it in there and we're going to pray for it in, you know, real time. So as you put requests up, we pray for them, and we're going to have a couple other, people from church, volunteers, people you see around here helping lead that this week. College students, if you're interested in helping lead a couple, let me know, because we want this to be an all-church thing, and we're going to pray together, because that's how we connect with God, and we want to do that regularly. So tune in, Facebook, 9 o'clock. Serving opportunities. We've got a new ministry we want to call your attention to, and if you've tuned in to the prayer time, we've mentioned this. But we have found out that some of the students who come to school here, if finances are an issue for their family, they might not have enough like hygiene products to make them comfortable at school, like toothpaste and deodorant, and for girls, sanitary products. And if you don't have that stuff, coming to school can be difficult. So we want to bless the students here with those things. So we've got a list in here. We're going to start collecting those. Linda Case has been in touch with a school nurse here, and she gave us this list. So we would really like to bless students. So if you can bring in any of these things, we're just going to collect them. We're going to give them to the nurse. She's going to distribute them as students need them. So if you can help out with that, just a great ministry, a way we can bless the students at this school. Also, keep saving your stuff. Free sale, April 6th. And we have a message from our missionary in the Dominican Republic, Lynn Costello. Michael connected with her this week, and she just wanted to give you guys a quick message, so go ahead and tune in. Hold on. Wait, before we do that, we have got offering as well. I almost forgot again. Ha ha! You guys are going to have to start hollering at me. So we've got our offering right now as well, so if the ushers could come forward, grab that. If you would like to text to give or give online, the info is there and in here. And just go ahead, and now you can watch Lynn give her message to you. Thanks, guys.
Hi, Rising Hope fam. This is Lynn down from the Dominican Republic. I just want to thank you so much for all of your prayers and your support. I'm definitely feeling them and lifted up and encouraged by you. So thank you for jumping on and for being so supportive and for just thinking of me. It really means a lot to have people in my hometown and back in the States that are lifting me up. So thank you so much.
Yeah, now I know you can hear me. Okay, that's better. All right, how are we doing this morning? Oh, my land. I'll tell you what, it's been quite the week this evening. Where am I? I don't even know. Wait, we got to try that again. Let me try that again. See, okay, no, that's all right. See, I get all bamboozled because my mic doesn't work and that sort of thing. I don't know if you want to trade this out or not, but I'll put it right down on the bottom here. All right. All right. If somebody on the tech team wants to come get that, and then we'll be good. Or if not, that's fine. Well, anyhow, welcome. I am so glad that you are here. I am Pastor Mike, and I have the privilege and blessing of pastoring Muncie's newest church. We are 5 months old. It's hard to believe that. We're not even quite, I think, crawling. Do babies crawl at 5 months? I don't think so. I don't think so. Not quite then. But we are so blessed and privileged just to watch God doing some amazing things. And I'm excited because last week we kicked off a brand new series. We're talking about something that a lot of us really don't have, and it's called margin. Some of you would be like, what is that? Tastes like butter? No, margin is not butter. It doesn't taste like that either. But it's one of these things, when we think about our time and we think about how busy we are and all the things that we are doing, it's just like we run life just 100 miles an hour, and it just, by the time we end the day, our heads hit the pillows, we crash, And it's like, what was that? And we wonder, how does time pass so fast? And the scary thing is this. As we think about this series, my hope, my prayer is this is not just another series where we think, oh, okay, that was nice, that was good. I kind of got my church this morning and I can check the box and go home. But I'm really praying as we dig into this series, it would be life-changing for you. Because quite honestly, if we don't really understand how to put margin in our lives, one of two things is going to happen. Either one, we're going to eventually wind up in self-destruct mode, or two, we are not going to realize the fullest of God's blessings that he has prepared for us. I mean, God wants us to have this life and live it abundantly, but if we have planned him right out of our schedule, it really is hard for God to work. And the last thing that I want is to have some midlife crisis or some stress, panic, anxiety, freak out moment. I mean, we need to be able to put margin in our lives so that we can see God work. Amen? Yeah, okay. Some of you aren't quite here, sort of. Okay, margin. It's like, well, Pastor Mike, you don't know my schedule. You don't know how busy I am, and I've got people counting me, and I've got decisions to make, and there's no way. Well, it's interesting about this. And again, I want to push you a little bit because it's a little bit like Jacob in the Bible. Remember him? He wrestled God. It said that he wrestled God. And my hope is that literally we could take a hold and wrestle God, and almost it's like if we said, God, I am not going to let you go until I have my blessing, right, in these areas that we're going to be looking at. Today, we're going to be looking at our health. And kind of I subtitled this message, Everybody Matters, emphasis on body. So I'm going to be talking about our bodies today when it comes to margin. But we're also going to look at our relationships. I mean, some of us, we're in good, healthy relationships. Some of them can go deeper. Others, we just need to figure out, like, this is not a good relationship for me. How do I have margin? How do I figure that out in the context of relationships? And then also finances. We're going to look at that. Now, some of us might say, what is margin in finances? Like, is that even remotely possible? Like, yes, it is, because God owns it and he wants to bless you. And we're going to be diving into that in the coming weeks. And then just also how to make decisions. Like when it comes to having margin to make sure we're allowing God to work. So as we dive in, I hope we can all say, you know what, God, I am going to hang on. I am not letting go. I'm going to wrestle with you until you bless me in these areas. And I got to tell you, I'm going to challenge you in some areas. And if you accept my challenge, I think we can not only change our lives, but our community as well. Okay, I'm going to plug this one back in and see if we can't go, because it's I just feel like constricted. I have to hang on to this. All right. I have a green dot. Yeah, there it is. Now I know it's on. Awesome. Hey, let's give our tech team a hand. They are awesome. Poor Hannah's back there. She's like, I don't know. Oh, you guys are great. You guys are great. That's awesome. So here's the deal. We're going to wrestle with God when it comes to margin. And, you know, here's the thing. I've heard a lot of messages in my lifetime at church, and it's kind of like, how do I help remember things? Well, let me just give you the Cliff Notes. Here's the Cliff Notes right now. And if you forget everything else, that's fine. But our theme verse, John chapter 3, verse 30, is this, that he would become greater. God would become greater and greater, and I would become less and less. Now, think about that for a moment. If you allowed God to become greater in your relationships, in your finances, and in your health, and just your coming and goings and dealings with people, how much more blessed would your life be right now? What do you think God is stirring in you this week to do? So there it is, that he would become greater, I would become less. That's really the secret sauce to this whole series and even message today. Now, last week, we kicked off this series of margin just kind of by defining it, giving a context to kind of launch us into this week and the coming weeks. And if you missed us, margin is literally the amount available beyond what is necessary. So if you arrive at 11:45 and you don't have to be there until noon, you have 15 minutes of margin, right? Or if you've got $100 and it costs $80, you've got $20 of margin. It's the amount available beyond what is necessary. Margin is also a kind of a buffer. It's that point of having distance between you and temptation. I don't know what your temptation could be. It could be Oreo cookies. It could be the great, like, poppy seed bread that you had on the way in that Shari baked. That was incredible. Like, you're like, I can't do that. I can't do that. Don't worry. I had a piece. It was safe. It tasted very good. But I had to put distance between myself and the second piece just because, like, I knew I would eat a second one and that would be selfish. But I thought about it, trust me. But it's that point in having kind of buffers, preset buffers. And last week, if you remember, I talked about if you're dating, right? And she's looking kind of pretty and he's looking kind of handsome and you're sitting in the car and you haven't really figured all that stuff out in relationships. But if you have your Bible between you, right? That's a preset buffer when you're dating to say, hey, I'm not crossing this line because I'm going to allow God to lead me in this area and lead this. So I don't know what preset buffers that you have to have, but if you missed last week's message, I'd encourage you to tune into that and check that out. But what matters most is that God becomes more and I become less. Now, admittedly, we're kind of selfish people. I mean, we are. It's true. And many of you, you know this. You are sitting on the couch at home and you're watching, you know, your favorite TV program and you're lounging and you're hanging out and all is good and you've got the remote control, you got it dialed into the program you want, and then for whatever reason, maybe you're reaching for the snack thing and then you come around and you realize, oh no, I dropped the remote. Now, you know as good as I do, like, you never drop the remote. Numerous reasons, but one, it is like out of my reach, and I do not want to get out of my chair. You know what I'm talking about. So you don't want to get out of the chair, and you're trying to like reach it as much as you can, and it's like, come here, I can't, and then you kind of try to do the Yoda thing, it doesn't come. And you're trying to get it, and like you're trying to pull it, and you're getting it, and then you're kicking it away, and you're like, here. And it's just like, why don't you just get yourself out of the chair, pick up the remote? But no, that's not what we do, right, dads? No, because we yell for a kid. Hey, Brianne. Oh, wait, she's in college. Kaylin, come here.
I can't, Dad. I'm getting ready for a date.
Okay, never mind. Andrew, Caleb, oh, they're already eating snacks in the, you know, kitchen. Okay, like, anybody, can you come here? And then finally Kim comes in, like, and she's like, what is it? I'm like, the remote fell in the floor. Could you get, and then she just turns away, like, are you kidding me? Like, we just don't want to get, am I the only one that knows what, am I the only one that does that? You just don't want to get out? I mean, but that's it. So where am I going with this illustration? It's really all to say this. It's kind of like, well, what have you done for me lately? It's so easy for our world, our planet, just to revolve around us. What should be done for us, right? Like, hey, how can I get out of debt? How can I maybe be skinnier? How can I be smarter? How can I do this? And it's me, and it's I, and it's all of these things. And it's very interesting. It even kind of bleeds, we got to be careful, into our worship. I know Kim one time, there was a study done on worship songs, and it started talking about how many times the word I was used instead of God, and it was kind of alarming. We are a selfish culture by nature. We don't want to bend down and pick up the remote. And so as we think about having margin, right, a lot of us, our mind goes to, well, how can I do this, and how can this be for me? But let me suggest there might be a better question. Let me suggest that there might be another way to look at this. Instead of asking what should be done for us, maybe the question has to do with others. What could maybe be done around me? What could be done through me? And so again, as we kind of launch into this series, here's kind of what I want to do. We need to be able to create margin in our lives. Now, we kind of laugh and scoff at the remote, but we've all been there. We all kind of know how that goes. But
What happens if we really allow God to say, okay, God, I'm going to give you more space in my life. I'm thankful that you don't cram this stuff down my throat. God, you allow me just to love you in an imperfect way, and you allow me to choose that. He didn't make us some robot where we have to worship. And God loved us that much to give us choice. And we want to make the choice today to say, God, I want to put margin into my life spiritually and financially. I want to put my margin in my life relationally. And also, I want to kind of have some fun with that. So how are we going to do that? So here's the deal. For the context of this series, here's a phone number on the screen, 616-581-7945. Go ahead and put that up there. And what I want you to do, I want you to create some health goals. It could be a weight loss goal. It could be a health goal. But I want you to text that into that phone number. Do we have the phone number? Do we have the phone number? We'll get it. There it is. 581-7945. And I want you to text that. I don't need your name. The name isn't, you know. And here's the deal. It's not any money that you have to give. I mean, you already blessed God with your offering today, and that was cool. But what we're going to do as a church is for those pounds and those goals, we're going to put a dollar amount to that, and we're going to give it away to feed some hungry kids and people in our community. Wouldn't that be cool? So let's just say maybe we have all of us here today, we add up the pounds, and it might be 100 pounds. Well, if we put a couple of dollars to that, that's $200 to help feed somebody that's hungry. And so that's going to go to some kids. And this past week, matter of fact, I helped somebody that was homeless. I'm like, man, where are you sleeping? At the laundromat, under the table. I'm like, no, you're not. No, you're not. That's not going to happen. And so I had this opportunity to be Jesus. And we have an opportunity right here as a church to be Jesus to others, to make, again, it's not about me, it's not about us, but those around us, how could we make a difference? And what could God do through me? Well, I think it would be really cool to feed some people that are hungry around our community. So the next time that maybe you pick up the remote and you're sitting there, and before you bellow for your roommate or anybody else to, you know, or your spouse or your kids, you're going to get up and you're going to get it and you're going to remember, hey, I just burned a calorie doing that, and I helped feed somebody that was hungry. So we're going to have some extra motivation. We're going to have some fun with that. But now some of you, you're already checking out. You're like, I ain't going to do that because I know how you feel. I know how you feel tomorrow. Why don't you tune into this video, because I know you're going to look a little bit like this. So that's going to be you in the morning. How many might think that could possibly happen? Yeah, like a lot of us, like, yeah, Josiah playing the trombone. Okay, anyhow. So how are we going to make the changes that we need to? And really the question that you're asking, I think, is why? Like, why would I do that? Okay, yeah, it's good to maybe feed some people that are hungry, but why do I need to begin making a change in my life or a lifestyle change or whatever that health goal may be? Why? It's an important question. Well, here's the answer to that. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. You can follow along on the screen. It says, whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, here it is. Here's the answer. Do it what? For the glory of God. That's the answer. So when somebody asks you, hey, I notice you, you know, having a little bit more fruits and vegetables, and, you know, you're not eating second helpings, and like, what are you doing? I'm just doing it for the glory of the God. That's what I'm doing. And by the way, I even sent this text in, and we're trying to feed some people in the community. That's why I'm doing it. That's hopefully your answer. I want to do it for God's glory. 1 Corinthians 10:31. But when you preach on health in a church, this is where it really gets good. It's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. And we're going to be reading a little bit more, and even in Corinthians 6 in a minute. But 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, may the God of peace, some of us, we don't have peace because we don't have margin. But notice God throws in peace there. May the God of peace make you holy in every way and make your whole spirit and soul, and help me out, and body be kept blameless until our Lord Jesus Christ comes again. Right there it is. God thinks, he's thinking about our physical body. He tells us that. And he wants it to be kept blameless. Now, Paul, who's writing this to the Corinthian church at this point, they're acting like they've lost their mind. They're just kind of doing everything and anything that they want. And he's like, no, you can't do this. This is, no. And so what I want to do today, I want you to realize three things when it comes to your body. Number one, you're going to be passionate about your body. You're going to be prepared for your eternal body. And three, to be part of a church body. So prepared, passionate, and part of a church. So let's dial into that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12 through 20. It's a lot of verses, but just hang with me. Here it says. It says, you say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. And even though I'm allowed to do anything, I must not become a slave to anything. You say, food was made for the stomach, and the stomach for the food. This is true, though someday God will take away both of them. But you can't say that our bodies were made for sexual immorality. They were what? They were made for the Lord, and the Lord cares about our bodies. And God will raise us from the dead by his power, just as he raised our Lord from the dead. Don't you realize that our bodies are actually parts of Christ? Should a man take his body, which is a part of Christ, and join it to a prostitute? Never. And don't you realize that if a man joins himself to a prostitute, he becomes one body with her? For the scriptures say, the two are united into one. But the person who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Run from sexual sin. No other sin clearly affects the body as this one does. For sexual immorality is a sin against your own body. Don't you realize that your body, here it is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God. That's huge. I'm going to unpack that a little bit more in a bit. You do not belong to yourself. Here it is. For God bought you with a high price. So you must honor God with what? Your body. And before we dive into that and unpack this, there are three unhealthy attitudes that we need to realize when it comes to feeling like the polar bear, when it comes to not picking up the remote. And there's one healthy one, and that's what I want to start with. So the first unhealthy attitude is that we reject our body. I mean, and right now, some of you, you're like, why do I have to talk about this right now? I've had a body that I think when God made me, it was like an oops. Like, oops. Like, God, let me tell you, there are no oopses. I mean, God made your body, so don't reject it. Number two, the flip side of this is got to have the perfect body. Got to have the perfect body. I mean, some people, right? Some people are too sexy for the shirt, and some people can't fit into their shirt. Some people have like 25 vitamins and supplements, and some others on the other side can't even spell vitamins. I mean, we sometimes go after this perfect body, and it's so misleading. It's so judgmental. It's so condemning. And I especially feel for our women here, because from a very young age, it's like, well, what size do you wear? I'm a zero. What? Obviously, the person that came up with the size zero never had a math class, because zero is nothing. And yet, what do? We put the standard to women at a zero? Like, come on already. True story, my brothers, listen, he can attest to this. My mom went out one day and bought me a pair of pants. I liked these pair of pants. They felt really good. I was 12 years old. I was kind of starting to come into that puberty time when I didn't know what things were happening in my body. And then my brother saw the name tag on the back of the pants, and it said Husky. Wait a minute, why are you laughing? It ain't funny. Yes, I wore the Husky pants. And my brother made fun of me all the time. And I got to tell you, it didn't make me feel good. That was just as a 12-year-old kid. But guys, we know this, we're even being pushed more, right? We got to have a six-pack, got to have a six-pack. It's a six-pack, it's a size zero. And so what Satan does is he just guilts us and he shames us. Listen, today's message is we're in a judge-free zone. I want to let you know that. And it's not about losing weight. It's about caring for our body like God does. And when we care for it, we're going to put margin in, and we're going to attend to it because it's his temple. And we want to treat it accordingly. My body belongs to to God. And it's something, my body is not something that should be ignored nor adored. So we're not going to reject it. And we're not going to try and have the perfect one. And that leads me to kind of the third wrong attitude about our body is you cannot do nothing. You got to do something. And I think there's probably not a person here that couldn't do something today. Now, I got to tell you something. I have been like the polar bear with his foot or with his face on the ice. Just, I've been trying to do this and I haven't done it yet. And this is going to lead me to my third point. Remember, we're part of a church body. Church, I need to tell you, like, I need your help on this. Because I got to tell you, hitting the treadmill, going out and running, you know, exercising, I don't like doing those things. I've always pretty much had the metabolism to kind of stay in shape, but I'll tell you, I'm in 2015, I started training for a marathon. And I was very close to it, but I ended up tearing the labrums in both my hips. And since 2015, I have become like rigid like a board. I am not flexible. I used to be able to do the splits. I used to be pretty flexible, but now I'm serious. I'm not putting this on. Like, I'm going to try and touch my toes. Like, that's as far as it gets. And I've got this, like, thing that's hanging over my belt. You might not be able to see it. That doesn't feel really good either. And so here's the deal. Like, I've tried to. I really wanted to preach this message because I knew it was coming. Trust me, I've had to live with this message for 2 weeks, and it's been awful. And all I had to do is pick up the phone and call the Y and say, when's the next yoga class? I do not want to do yoga. I'm going to feel like a turtle, like on its shell. Like, ah, I don't know how that is. I should probably take a video of it, and I can earn money vlogging because people would laugh so bad. I mean, it's coming. I mean, it's bad. I don't even know if I can do a sit-up anymore. I mean, it's pathetic. But here's the third wrong attitude. We cannot neglect our body. We've got to do something. God wants us to respect our body. We've got to be stewards of it. Three reasons why this is important. Number one, our body was created by God. Psalm 139, it says that God, when he thought of us, he says that we are wonderfully and fearfully made. We are knit together in the mother's womb. Our body was created by God. That should give us all the reasons to respect it. But number two, as we're still unpacking Corinthians 6, our body was worn by God. John chapter 1, verse 14, and it says, and the Word became flesh, that's Jesus, and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Man, what a thought. Our body is worn by God. It's an interesting thing about God wearing our bodies and people wearing stuff. Any baseball fans in the house this morning? Okay, you know this. Okay, you're going to feel me on this one. Babe Ruth wore number 3. He was also my favorite baseball player. He was adopted. Grew up in Baltimore, Maryland, where my dad grew up. A few neighborhoods from his. I saw his boyhood home. I even wrote his wife a letter because I was so enamored, but she had just died like a few weeks. I was crushed as a little kid as I was trying to collect baseball cards and everything. But here's the thing. Do you know a 1920, like, road jersey that Babe Ruth wore and signed? Again, it's God. Where's our body? Babe Ruth wore this jersey. You want to know how much it went for? How much it sold for? How many of you would say more than $1 million? $2 million. Keep your hands up. $3 million. $4 million. Still at $4 million? You're close. May 20th, 2012, sold on Heritage Auction. Forget this. $4,415,658. A Babe Ruth road jersey. It's all about who wore it. God has worn our body. Now, here's the deal. If I got you, and it's in my chest at home, if I got you my baseball jersey that says Hewitt on the back, like, and if I tried to auction that off or asked you to wear it, like, I would have to pay you to do that. I have to pay you to do that. Here's the thing. It's all about who wears it. God has worn our body. Our body was created by him, and it's worn by him. And number 3, our body was purchased by God. 1 Corinthians 6, 19-20. As we think about this, right? I mean, if Jesus right now, if Jesus came to your house, he just like, before you left church today, Jesus said, I'm coming to your house for dinner. I'm coming to your dorm room for dinner. What are you going to feed him? College students, like Cheetos, Pringles, I don't know. But if Jesus was coming to dinner, you would probably want to fix him a really good meal. Like the best that you could. Throw some steaks on the grill, ask him what he likes, just whatever your favorite meal was, that's probably what you would do. But as we think about this, if our body was purchased by God and he's literally, that's part of the temple of the Holy Spirit, that this is our body, wouldn't you want to take care of it? And where does it start and end? A lot of it starts and ends in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. This is where it starts. It says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. I know that there's going to be no way I can touch my toes if I don't change some of the ways that I think when it comes to food and exercise. Verse 2, and you'll learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. There it is. You want to know God's will? There it is. Let your mind be transformed. So as we think about this, and this is tough because some of us, we have battled like some of the stuff our whole lives. And again, this is not a message about guilt. It's a message about grace and doing something because we can't neglect our body. So here it is, three encouraging steps. Passionate. We've got to be passionate about having a healthy body. Here's kind of a fun poem. Maybe that I found. It says, one person put it this way. I don't even know who wrote it, but here it is. It says, God populated the earth with vegetables of all kinds so that humans would live long and healthy lives. And Satan created the 99-cent double cheeseburger. He also said to humans, do you want fries with that? And humans said, supersize it. And humans gained pounds. And God created healthy yogurt, but Satan froze the yogurt and brought forth chocolate M&Ms and brightly colored candy to put on top of the yogurt, and humans gained more pounds. And then God brought forth running shoes, and humans resolved to lose all those extra pounds, but Satan brought forth cable TV, and yes, you better believe it, remote controls and potato chips. And the humans clutched his remote and ate his chips, and Satan saw this and said, it is good. And humans went into cardiac arrest, and God sighed and created quadruple bypass surgery, and Satan created HMOs. So we think about that funny poem. Do you realize 70% of people here in the United States are overweight? 40% of those are kids. Last year, when we looked at the amount of fuel that we used, we used 1 billion more gallons of gas than the year before. You want to know why? It's because we gained more weight. 1 billion gallons. That's crazy. You want to drink a 20-ounce soda? You have to run 4.5 miles to burn it off. For a 20-ounce soda, 4.5 miles. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6:12, all things are not helpful. So what is he doing? What is he doing in Corinthians 6? What he's doing is he's taking a spiritual principle and he's talking about our bodies. Now, that's what he's doing. When we think about sugar, Lucky Charms, 6 teaspoons of sugar. Lunchables, you'd think a Lunchable at school, there's 9 teaspoons of sugar. Do you realize that the average kid in a year eats 150 pounds of sugar? The average kid, 150 pounds. It's crazy. 1 Corinthians 9, 25 through 27 says this. And lovingly, this is kind of what we're talking about. So these are the things that we don't want to do sometimes. It says, all athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it why? To win a prize that will fade away. But what? We do it for an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. I'm not just shadow boxing. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified. Physical training does have some value. The Bible tells us that in Timothy. It tells us that we need to be disciplined in this, but it will fade away. And here's the deal. Health does not start in the doctor's office. It starts here. It starts where you work. It starts where you live and where you play. And as Christians, as the Holy Spirit lives in us, as a result, we should be passionate about our body. Number two, we need to be prepared. This is good. Prepared for our heavenly body. 1 Corinthians 15:53 says, "For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies." So, Paul, what is he saying here? He's like, we're going to get a new body. Can I get an amen to that? Like, that's cool. I'm touching my toes again. But here's the deal. God is saying, hey, I care for you and your body and how you're treating it and how you look at it. So are you doing anything with it? Now, here's the deal. Some of us, we work out 4 or 5 times a week. And we train, and we're leaning more towards the perfect body. But let me ask you, are you as passionate spiritually about your body? Are you sharing your faith? Are you memorizing scripture? Are you dialing into the 21 days of prayer at 9 p.m. over the next couple of weeks that we've been doing? I mean, these are all things. Ultimately, we need to prepare our bodies because what? It's going to be transformed into a new and heavenly one. And I don't know how quite all that's going to work. I mean, we already said that the stomach, we're not going to get that anymore and that sort of thing. And there's things that are just going to be different. But there are certain things that I don't want to take with me as I get my heavenly body. I'm just saying. I just don't want that. That's an amen. At the age of 6 months, there's a good amen. Thank you for that. 1 Timothy 4:8, physical training is good, but training for godliness is much better, promising benefits in this life and the life to come. So I have to ask you, are you feeding yourself spiritually so that you can put the margin in your lives where you need them most? The last thing. So we should be passionate about our bodies. We should be prepared for our heavenly bodies. And the third thing, I already referenced this a little bit, is we should be part of a church body. Romans chapter 12, verse 4 and 5 says, "Just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body." And I love this part. We all belong to each other. I got to tell you, I don't know. I honestly don't know if I could do the yoga class or if I could get back into the exercise that I know I need to without my church family. I'm just saying. And so I'm just asking you as your pastor, like, and if you want to invite me into your world by, again, tech, don't just be flippant about it, but saying, this is my goal. This is my health goal. Or this is kind of what I would like to lose. But hold me accountable as well. Hopefully next week I will have called the why, and I will figure it out, like what the downward dog is and all these other crazy positions that I hear about in yoga class. But we need to do that. But we're part of a church body, and I got to tell you, we are only 5 months old, but do you understand the things that are happening as a result of this church body? And worship team, if you want to come up right now, that would be great as we kind of round third base into this message and come home. But here's the deal. Right now, we have been renovating our church through you. It's something I couldn't do on my own. We don't have enough finances to pay for all of it on our own. But through us, that is happening, and it's awesome. Through us, we are seeing prayers being answered in our 21 days of prayer as we've been dialing that up on Facebook Live. If you don't have Facebook, that's okay. You know, here's the cool thing about prayer. God is outside of time. Like, he's not confined. So here's the thing. Have you ever said, oh, I missed it. I was supposed to pray at that time. I missed it. You know what? I realized, wait a minute. God's outside of time. And even if I pray after the baby was born for a safe delivery, God will still honor that. Isn't that cool? Like, God is not held to that. And coming out of our last series, right, where 2 or 3, remember that, are gathered in his name, God's presence is with us. And so I encourage you to pray. I mean, some of you, you've joined the Bible reading plan. You're like, oh, I joined it, but I haven't been on that in like a week. Jump back on. Yeah, we're doing this Bible reading plan. I mean, it is awesome. I mean, you know what? We can grow a church and we can grow big and thousands of people. You know what? I'd rather go deep, deep. This margin stuff is tough stuff. We're wrestling God with this. And I hope and I pray that you would be saying, just like Jacob, God, I am not going to let go until you bless me. God, I'm going to get my rear into the yoga class. I'm going to hold on, and I don't care if people make fun of me. I don't care because I love this body that you made me. I'm going to be passionate. I'm going to be prepared for eternity. And God, help us as a church family to be part of the family to get where we're going. And this might be a little scary for you, but I would encourage you to have a buddy. And just to say, outside of maybe who you came with, outside of a spouse, to say, hey, how did you, hey, Mike, Pastor Mike, did you go to yoga? Did you call him today? You can feel free, text me, or whatever. I don't care. If you want to pray for me, I gave you my number. I gave you my cell phone number. What pastor does it in the context of church and throws it live on the web? I don't know. I don't care. But I do that because we're part of a body, and I don't want to do life without you. I really don't. And I know that through us, we can make the difference. Not only in our lives that we're praying for our body, but in those lives that are hungry, that are praying, and saying, God, if you were there, would you show me that you are here? And people, Rising Hope, friends, first-time guests, we have an opportunity, truly, not only to change our lives, but those around us. That's something I want to pray about. Why don't you stand with me and pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for who you are. And God, I know we probably all don't say it a lot. We don't thank you for our body. Lord, we probably, if we're to be honest, we probably put down your creation because we don't like what we see in the mirror. But God, the cool thing is, God, we can change our mind, we can renew it, and we can change some of that. And God, for the stuff that we can't change, this is great. We can pray for one another. We can encourage one another. We can say, hey, let's go walking together. Let's eat better. Let's just shop together for groceries. I don't know, God, but some of that we can do. But Lord, I know that there's some of us here, we are praying for things. Some of us, I know this past week, cancer, there's little guy Brandon, and their parents are trying to figure out, do we just help with quality of life, or do we try this new procedure? God, some of us are really hurting when it comes to our body, and we are praying to you for healing, to do the things that are out of our control. And so, Lord, I pray that we can begin to do what we need to do to have margin when it comes to our bodies physically. And so, Lord, this is something that we need to pray about. Because I'm praying that the decisions made today would bring you glory and they would bring you honor. And God, and in doing so, we can create more margin in our lives. God, maybe, I don't know what that looks like. Maybe that's more years with the grandkids. Maybe that's, God, I don't know. I don't know what it could be. But Lord, I just pray that we could just live this life. And God, we can be passionate about the very gift that you gave us. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, amen. So just like in every service each week, one of the things we believe in the power of prayer here. And so for some of you, I want you to pray about that. What this means for you to do those three things as we're creating margin, as we're changing lives. And so as the worship team leads us in the song, if you want to come and pray, come down and pray. If you can't even kneel, that's fine. If you can't come down, that's, you're not there yet, that's okay too. But I want to say this, we're part of a church. We need one another. And there's power in prayer. So this time is yours. And if you want some other prayer, I'd be happy to be down in front just to pray a prayer of blessing over you. So this time is yours. Let's continue our time of worship.
trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
Joy. And I want to just ask you, as you do that this week, take the time to thank God for what he's given you to be able to do that with. Have a great week. See you next week.